Brian Nobles, good morning.
Hey, Bill, good morning. I'm very impressed that you knew that the Sunday edition of the Observer Dispatch came out on Sunday. That was pretty impressive.
Well, let me tell you, it's you say that's a given. I got to tell you, read through some of your cleaning products and look at some of the disclaimers that are on there. You'd be like,
you don't need that. You're right.
Don't Better drink this.
Sorry. You're 100% right.
Anyway. So you are a Bills fan. I'm feeling hope this year for the Bills.
Nobody wins the offseason like the Buffalo Bills.
That's
you know
exactly
that.
Right, and it can't be put any better than that. But the Mets, it's been quite interesting. They were at the Carrier Dome yesterday, Ryan.
I saw that, yeah, and there's a little bit of flap with Noah Syndergaard, right?
Well, he grabbed the Syracuse flag and was running around the dome, and everybody loves him again, and DeGrom got his deal, and it looks like it all seemed to work. It looks like they kind of had a good time in Syracuse, to be honest.
Well, honestly, Noah Syndergaard here was playing the long game because there's nothing that folks in upstate New York, central New York, love more than a high-priced athlete from somewhere else knocking on their hometown.
That's right. That's right. So you're right. We don't. We don't have thin skin.
So he knew that if he gave Syracuse a gentle nudge, a little knock, and hinted that they weren't as good as some other places in the world, that people from Syracuse would rise up and be mad, which they were, predictably. And now he can run it all back by coming and running the flag and planting it in the center of the Carrier Dome, and now he'll be everybody's favorite player. So it's he was playing a long game here, I think.
Yeah,
I think it probably worked out well.
I agree. And listen, if you're a Mets fan and you're in Syracuse and he wins, it doesn't even matter what he says at this point.
It doesn't matter at all. And, I think what he said about Syracuse was stupid and wrong.
Yeah.
And of course, nobody defends upstate New York more than me. I do think he had a point, though, about the idea that a couple
Scheduling.
Of days before
yeah.
the season starts,
mm-hmm.
that they go to an unknown place. I mean, it could have been Cancun for, that didn't really matter. But the idea that you're, 2 days away from the start of your season, and you've got to fly all the way.
Yep.
They're going to open here in Washington. We're going to the game on Saturday. I can understand why that maybe annoyed him a little bit. And I don't think it especially had anything to do with Syracuse.
Yeah,
I totally agree, Ryan. And in fairness, Syndergaard's response to having to go to Syracuse was, oh, I don't want to go. I can't believe this. Syracuse's response was, oh, we have to host the Mets. Are you kidding me?
Yeah. I hate to bring this with a different opinion, but he really didn't criticize Syracuse. He really criticized the Mets' scheduling and saying, we need a day to be able to get our affairs in order before this long grind starts. And I think that, like anything, it wasn't like Pete Davidson coming out and saying, what a sewer this Syracuse is. One giant sewer.
And I think, too, I think that it, to Jeff's point, it's not as if when it was unveiled that the Mets were going to be the new farm system in Syracuse and they were going to call them the Syracuse Mets, that the people in Syracuse embraced them with open arms. There was a lot of skepticism there. And
yeah.
I'd venture to guess that it's more of a Yankee town than anything. So it's going to take some time for both sides to win each other over. So
I
think that worked out pretty well. It seems like that was, a pretty good crowd at the Dome. And, we'll see if this happens. Like, they can build a fan base in Syracuse. I think that'd be good for everybody.
Listen, we saw it in 86. The way you build a fan base is you win a world championship, period.
Yes.
That's how you build a fan base.
It has nothing to do with where your farm club is.
That's exactly it. I mean, they're going to love having the Mets in town if they can win. So, all right, I want to ask you Mueller report. And it looks like today there's news out that William Barr is going to release this report within a couple of weeks.
Yeah, which
anyway.
Yeah, and I think that people are frustrated by that. I think that a couple of weeks versus a couple of days, I think there are a lot of people on Capitol Hill in particular that thought it should be a couple of hours.
Yeah.
I think that there's a lot of skepticism, particularly within the Democratic circles, and I think even some Republicans that are worried that the longer he holds on to this report, that it opens the door for criticism that he's going to try and color it in some way, shape, or form and scrub it of information that could be pertinent and interesting to people. I am not among the people, and I'm usually somebody that's 100% for as much transparency as possible, who thinks that there's a benefit to just releasing the report in its totality, because I do think there's probably some sensitive information in there
sure.
that shouldn't necessarily see the light of day. That being said, The more of it that we can see, the better. And I do think it's a little hypocritical for Republicans who wanted to see every single document pertaining to Hillary Clinton's past related to every single one of the controversies that she was caught up in that are now saying it would be unfair for the president if this information were to come out.
Yeah.
So it's not an easy job that Bill Barr has. He kind of signed up for this when he wrote that memo talking about the special counsel and auditioning for the job. He knows what he's up here against. But I do think, Bill, long term, there's a lot more danger for Democrats right now than there is for Republicans because, Donald Trump was successful in kind of zeroing in on this idea that collusion was the most important thing that Robert Mueller was looking into. And if there isn't a smoking gun, I think we know that definitively. And if Democrats keep picking at this scab, there's a real good chance that it could come back to bite them.
Well, even obstruction of justice, you're not going to get anywhere on that. If you're the Democrats and you're looking at this and you're saying, and to be fair, we don't know what's in the report, but chances are. What is in there is not going to be as much of a smoking gun as they would need in order to turn the Senate and to do anything in terms of punishment or impeachment or anything like that. You got to have the Senate. So where are they going?
I talked to Chuck Grassley yesterday, who's the former chairman of the Judiciary Committee from Iowa, who's been kind of the president's defender in all this, and he's been very critical of the special counsel. And his point yesterday, and I don't think he necessarily has strong legal ground to make this perspective, but I think it gives you kind of some insight into the thinking of Republicans right now, in that his argument is that it's impossible to obstruct justice if there isn't an underlying crime that you're attempting to obstruct from.
Right, right.
So if he didn't collude, then he can't get in the way of an investigation into something that didn't occur. Now, legal experts will tell you that's not true. You absolutely 100% can obstruct an investigation, even if you're not guilty of the underlying crime.
Right.
But this is where we get into that kind of sticky wicket of the difference between a legal argument and a political argument. And I think you made that point very importantly there, Bill, when we started this conversation. You need such definitive and clear evidence that this was something that was done maliciously and wrong that meets that standard of high crimes and misdemeanors, and you've got to get Republicans to buy into that if you think you're going to impeach Donald Trump. And I think if there's no collusion, and maybe he did do some stupid things to obstruct the process of investigating that, that's a difficult argument to make to Republicans, especially for a guy that still has 85% approval rating within their party.
Right.
I think this ship has sailed. I think they need to stop concerning themselves with trying to impeach Donald Trump and focus more on these kitchen table issues, because the polls show that most Americans are on the side of Democrats with a lot of these big things that they're talking about, and they've got a much better shot at winning an election if they bring the battle to that ground as opposed to trying to win it over here, talking about corruption and all these other things that have dominated the headlines for the last year or so.
And how do those Democrats that came out in interviews, and it'll be held against them, that said there is absolute evidence that the president colluded. How do they go forward? And you just forget that you said that?
Well, honestly, and this is, I think, a fair criticism, they're going to take the Donald Trump tactic with this and say, well, I didn't say it exactly like that, I meant it like this, or they're going to try and spin and turn themselves in knots trying to make some sort of an argument, or even say that they don't agree with this, after spending 2 years saying that Robert Mueller was a Boy Scout, they're going to now say that he wasn't and that he didn't do his investigation thoroughly enough. 2,000 documents, more than 300 subpoenas, 2.5 years. I mean, so, I think it puts him in very difficult ground. This is the problem. And, Bill, you and I talked about this from the very beginning. We don't know. We don't have any idea what Mueller had found. All
right.
We had was a very base level understanding of what he was looking into. And it was very dangerous for anybody to suggest.
Yep.
That they knew what was going to be the ultimate outcome. And so there's a lot of people with egg on their face as a result of that. And that's why I think, some of these voices on the Democratic side that have been the loudest, Eric Swalwell's, Richard Blumenthal of Connecticut, you have the Tom Steyer wing of the party that is still calling for impeachment. Those, they can no longer be the leading voices if the Democrats, in terms of the Democrats' 2020 argument, and I still think you need to go back and watch the things that Nancy Pelosi has said from the very beginning. I don't think there's been a politician in America that's been smarter about this than her. She's never called for impeachment. She warned her members not to take this too far. And she encouraged all of those folks that were running in these marginal House districts, and yours is a perfect example of that.
Mm-hmm.
How much is Anthony Brindisi talking about Russia?
Well, let me tell you.
At all, right?
Brindisi's statement was, listen, I feel the public, we all deserve to see the report, and we cannot get bogged down in investigations, because when we do that, we're not going to be taking care of the people's business.
Exactly.
And that's spot on, I think.
And that was mimicked in, 150 congressional districts across the country, and that's why she's the Speaker of the House.
Yeah.
And I can tell you, on the campaign trail now, Bernie Sanders talks about, this past week, he's mentioned it at the top of every one of his speeches as an addendum to an already prepared speech just because it was in the news. He never talks about the Russia investigation.
Yeah, yeah.
He's talking about health care. He's talking about Social Security. He's talking about expanding the minimum wage and breaking up big corporations. Those are what he thinks are winning issues.
Yeah.
And Kamala Harris yesterday calling for a $13,000 raise for teachers. That's how these 2020 candidates think they're going to win. And honestly, I think that you're going to see Donald Trump be the one that talks more about Russia now, because he is going to be able to pound his chest and say, I was right and you were wrong. And so I just think you'll see the conversation change quite a bit.
Ryan Nobles, as always, we appreciate it, and we'll do it again next week.
All right, let's go Mets.
Let's go Mets. Yes, I'm with you. All right, thanks, Ryan.
See you guys.